Hello and welcome to Chad and Cherry's Surf Music Review. I'm Chad Shivers.
I'm Cherry.
And today we have a special guest, Lester. So Lester plays with me in the Mystery Men, and he's also part of the Southern Ska Syndicate. So Lester, beyond that, will you tell us a little bit about yourself and maybe even your connection to surf music?
Sure, yeah. I've been playing, I started playing in college. Mm-hmm. Just because my roommate had a guitar, and I think probably 3 weeks after I picked it up, I was played a punk rock gig.
Nice.
Which it was probably pretty much a disaster, which was awesome. We realized that at that point that you know, you could be horrible and
that's what it's all about.
Another day.
Yeah.
And I've been kind of doing it since then. You know,
yeah, and you were even in the Night Porters for a while, right? Which was like a pretty legendary Atlanta, like punk or new wave band, right?
Yeah, I would think they're kind of a little bit of both. Yeah, mm-hmm. Kind of a little bit clashy, a little bit of the, you know, kind of new wavy stuff too. But that was a long time ago.
Now, what was the first surf band that you had joined into?
I was in a band called Gemini 13,
mm-hmm.
and I had been listening to, you know, it's a funny story. The first time, you know, I had gotten some, you know, I branched out from, you know, in the 79, 80, all my friends and kind of everybody at school was listening to, at high school was listening to kind of proggy stuff, and you know, all the bands that were big at the time, whether it was Led Zeppelin or Boston or, you know, more mainstream stuff, and kind of then got into the punk rock stuff, and they kept referencing back to, you know, I think a lot of people that start listening to punk rock started finding different things, you know. It was like you get, you know, like there were only so many records available, and also you wanted some, you know, maybe some different flavors,
mm-hmm.
and so started listening to surf and you know, rockabilly and garage, just, you know, the kind of peripheral things that influenced right punk rock. And I got a chance to see The Ventures. I think it was like 1980.
You told me this story. This is a great story. You want to tell the folks at home.
Oh, so I was like, you know, this is well before cell phones, of course. It was like 1980. And my buddy, I was living in Iowa City, Iowa, and my buddy who lived in about 40 miles east, 50 miles east in Davenport, you know, said, and the Avengers are playing tonight, you know, get some people, come on down, you know. And I thought he said the Avengers, which at the time was a kind of a seminal San Francisco punk rock band. So I got, you know, three or four of my friends, we piled in a car and cruised on down there. And it was a, you know, it was a car show. And and we were, you know, the youngest people by decades.
Oh, yeah.
And but, you know, never mind, you know, still it's like, all right, this could be great. And mm-hmm. I think we entered the twist contest.
Nice.
after a pyramid of beers, and
right.
I think they nearly ejected us, but we ended up seeing the Ventures, and of course,
nice.
They were great.
Nice.
It was I think one of my friends had a homemade fear t-shirt on. And one of the roadies came up, one of the Ventures roadies came up and was like, hey, wow, I can't believe in Iowa there's somebody like Spirit. And I was like, I'm roommates with East Bay Ray.
Oh, wow.
The Kennedys. And,
yeah.
And, which, of course, they have, you know, they have, you know, whether they kind of admit it or not, he's got sort of a surf influence,
yeah, totally,
on his guitar.
Yeah.
So, you know, all those things were kind of, you know, even though it was like, you know, they were, seemed impossibly old at that point.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the all those things kind of came together, I think. And that's what I really enjoy about surf music and about, you know, the surf scene and everything now is you can still do that, you know. And we can talk about with the Freneticos too, because we got an opportunity to meet them. And but I've always felt, you know, I'd rather see, you know, there's just something really immediate about going to see a band and being, you know, not just being a consumer and laying some money out, but being part of the show too, you know, whether mm-hmm. it's just being up front and going nuts or, you know, whatever, helping make flyers or being involved in some way. So I think there needs, people need to seek those opportunities out. And I guess this is an opportunity here.
That's awesome. Amen. And we appreciate you being here. Yeah. And so, okay, so what are we listening to today?
So we are listening to Los Freneticos from Argentina. And their album, this is so hard for me to say, Teletransportacion.
Yeah.
So this is their third album. It's from 2019 on High Tide Records. This is, we've done several High Tide releases now. So we've got a cool
chartreuse looking lemony color here.
And of course, unless I told you before we started taping here, we are still in our theme. This is week two of our Planes, Trains, and Automobiles. So of course, Transportacion, and we're doing all kind of transportation
songs today
and stuff. So we're going to start off with Last Train to Ozal.
Okay.
And I'm sorry if I'm not pronouncing that correctly. It's like vacation.
It is like vacation.
In my professional opinion, they're good. It's just so well produced.
Yeah, it really is.
I forget the guy's name who's in production here, but he's an original Argentinian rocker. I should have looked that up before.
Well, it says it on here somewhere.
But
Lito Nevia. I don't know how to say that.
Nevia. But it's like,
oh, okay. I'm putting two and two together here.
Yeah, look at the dynamics in this part too. It's just like, you know, just it's not forced or anything. It's just like I guess it's just the songwriting, you know. It's like, you know, everybody tries to get those elements and stuff in there, but sometimes it can be forced. Like, you know, all right, this is gonna be the quiet part. We need this. Right. We're gonna bring it down.
Yeah.
But it's just you're playing the same part, but it's just quieter.
Yeah.
And it's like that really has kind of it takes it somewhere, and you know, then back in the song. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. These guys. So Lester and I had the pleasure of playing with these guys. They flew in for a show in Atlanta, and they played at 529 with Mystery Men to nobody, and they were so awesome. It was like they were playing for hundreds of people, or thousands of people.
Yeah, exactly.
It did not matter that room was empty, because it was a Tuesday night. We just couldn't corral the folks out that night. I think it was, I want to say it was like pretty soon after Stomp Fest too, so we might have
blown our load. I mean, we ended up playing, but I think there were four mans on the bill, and were kind of thrown together. They didn't really have a theme for the night.
Yeah.
Which is all, you know, a weekday night.
Right.
With no theme, and you're an out-of-town band that no one's heard of.
Right.
So, yeah, it felt, you know what I really felt bad was that Chad texts me or calls me about 9 in the morning, and It says, hey, you know, the Frenetico's need a place to stay. And I was like, yeah, yeah, okay. Thinking, you know, well, I got a couple extra bedrooms, thinking, well, okay, they're gonna get here, we'll, you know, we'll do some stuff, and then I'll send them on their way for dinner, and I'll make up the rooms and everything. I didn't realize that they had taken the red eye from Los Angeles. And so they got there, my son's room was, you know, a disaster, and the guest room had been it was not good.
Man, that's just.
And they were just like, oh, this is great. They were just so grateful and awesome. They're like, this is, we were just so appreciative and
that's awesome.
Yeah, and so I thought I remember hearing this. They had just gotten their record, and I want to say that the first time that they actually needle dropped this record was at Lester's house.
Okay.
So the first time that they heard that, that's what my memory tells me. We could be wrong about that, but that's what I remember.
Yeah.
And yeah, those guys are just they're the nicest guys. Their live show, not only are they like tuneful and masterful songwriters, but their live show's nuts. Like they're just crawling under each other and just having a blast.
Yeah. I mean, it's like, you know, it's kind of like how, you know, like when I was younger, I think when I saw Hard Day's Night, you know, or the Monkees, and like, this is what a band's supposed to be like. Just like four crazy guys having fun 24/7.
Yeah.
And it's not always like that.
Right.
But it really seemed like that. I mean, particularly like when you're on the road or something, that they just maintained that. They were, you know, like just having a great time the whole time they were there. The fact that, like I said, we couldn't draw anybody after the show. It's like, did not matter. They were just soaking it in.
And they seem like that all the time. Like, I saw a picture of them today. They're in Mexico playing some shows right now. And the three guys are holding up the other guy like a surfboard, like the cover of like Surfer Girl or something from the Beach Boys. And just those guys are nuts and so much fun. So
very cool. Well, let's skip ahead a little and let's go to El Vagabundo.
Vagabundo.
Vagabundo. Los Gatos. Oh, sorry.
No, so Lester, you were saying that the producer is like a 60s, Argentinian rocker. So that was his band, was Los Gatos, and this is one of their songs.
Oh, okay.
So I didn't know that until like 20 minutes before we started filming this. Because I was reading the back, so El Vagabundo. There you go.
This sounds like a Straight Jacket song to me.
Yeah, totally. But this is that cover. Sounds like that,
yeah.
But I think it's just an organ that sounds like that theremin kind of sound.
Yeah, and is it a new record? Does it have keys on it? I think at this point when they recorded this, they had a keyboard player. I don't know if they continue doing keys.
I think it's just an additional person that does on the record. I don't know if they have like a live keyboard player or not. I don't know. They only have. They have a single after this, and I think they're working on the album. They might have a digital single that just came out, but they only have, like, physical media, they only have another single after this. And yeah, I think they're working on something. So, this record, Kevin Hunts with Dustin Owen, is kind of a comment on one of the guys actually lives in Germany. So they, like, record it and get together. I don't even know how that works, you know. I mean, it's kind of amazing what you can do sending files and stuff, but like, yeah. I didn't get that dynamic and get it down in a rehearsal room too, you know.
Yeah, they have one guitarist in Germany, and bass player and drummer, I believe, are in Cordoba, mm-hmm. which is kind of like the Austin of Argentina, as far as I know. It's kind of like college town in the center.
Isn't that like upper west corner?
It's fairly far north.
Yeah.
And then the other guitar player, as far as I know, he lives way, way, way out in basically the foothills of the Andes.
Oh wow!
And so I don't know if he comes back for months at a time but he lives in a small village way out there.
That's interesting. Well, very cool. So of course these guys are from Argentina. Actually, when we were chatting with them before the show, Cherry and I are trying to learn Spanish right now.
Yeah.
And their English is like impeccable, and they were a big kind of inspiration to me to like really get the ball rolling with my Spanish learning, you know. And we've hosted Los Tiki Phantoms here, Los Tiki Phantoms mm-hmm. played here and stayed here when they played at Stompfest that one year. And you know, it would have been nice to speak to them a little bit more in their language instead of the. And they spoke English very well, but
yeah, another group of really sweet and awesome guys.
Yeah, and so. Great performers. And,
yes.
So those Latin Latin bands, man, they're just they're killing it.
Yeah.
Okay, this is our final one. I should probably say we're drinking a Paradise Transport, not a tiki drink, more of like a resort kind of drink. Very piña colada-y.
Yeah, very coconutty. It's pretty good though.
Yeah,
it's
very delicious. Very refreshing mm-hmm. and delicious.
All right, I'll get this one right.
The title track, Teletransportación.
Wait for it.
Man, lots of counter melodies going on. I love all that stuff, whether it's the two guitars or a keyboard. The horns are just kind of more of the staffs, but really a lot of cool interplay between all the voices. Kind of a classic, almost surfy track.
Yeah, I was actually going to say the same thing. A very classic sounding tune. It could be pulled out of like any era of the surf spectrum.
Sure. Agreed, yeah.
Yeah, you know, they're so restrained. Like, I know these guys, haven't seen them live, they're all just brilliant musicians.
Mm-hmm.
But everything just serves the song. There's not, you know, there are like a bunch of elements in there, but it doesn't feel crowded. It doesn't feel like that it's just a bunch of noise, which is, it's not easy to do.
No.
Right. I'm a sucker for the horns, as Chad's pointed out already. So, and it kind of gives like a, almost like that train horn, almost like that blast, you know, like, mm-hmm. doo, doo, mm-hmm. you know.
Sure.
So, it's really cool. I like it. I heard bells in one of their trucks while we were listening to it today, so they definitely utilize variations of percussion throughout their album, mm-hmm. too. So, I appreciate that as well. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, overall, it's a banger of a record. Mm-hmm. You know, I could have picked any song.
Well, even I was, like, as we were listening to it today, I was like, I like this song. I like this song. And just, like, I've already picked out the songs, so.
Well, you picked it out. I think you explained to me earlier, you picked out songs because it had to do with your...
The theme.
Your monthly theme.
Right. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we don't always do a theme, but this was Cherry's idea to do the
Planes, Trains,
Automobiles, so...
working out really well right now.
Yeah.
I'm staying here tonight, by the way.
Okay, great.
I'll make up the bed.
I got it.
John Candy on you.
No problem.
You got a nice watch?
Casper.
Guys, if you haven't seen Planes, Trains, Automobiles, please
do yourself a favor.
Please watch it. It's so good. At any point,
I mean, it's a late 80, early 90. What year was it? Like 1989, I think, or 88 even. John Hughes movie, Steve Martin, John Candy. So good, so good. Talk about The Odd Couple, and it's just like I said last week. It just gets better as you age. Mm-hmm. I swear it does. I did not appreciate this movie the first time I saw it because I was way too young to really understand the angst and heartache and visceral hatred that was going through Steve Martin's head. But the older I get, I'm like, I'm becoming more like that.
Yeah, it seems like such a grown up. And you're like, now you can relate to it.
Yes.
John Candy, I heard, he just seems like an awesome dude as well, or was.
Yeah.
And I had one crew story that I heard through a friend was that it wasn't on Planes and Trains after he, you know, become famous, but on an earlier film, they were moving the dolly or something. And there was this new guy standing there, and they're like, hey, you know, thinking he was a production assistant, can you jump in here, and we should need some help with this. And in the middle of it, the actual PA was like, you know, Mr. Candy, we need you in makeup now. And he's like, just a minute, these guys need some help here, or just doing something.
Wow.
Nice guy. Yeah. Jumping in, awesome. Yeah. Well, this was great. This was fun.
Yeah. Lester, you got anything going on that you want to tell people about, or
with your music or anything?
We have a Mystery Men record coming out
eventually.
Eventually.
That's all we'll keep you posted. We'll keep you posted.
But until then, we'll be drinking and listening to music.
Yeah.
There you go. I like that. Cherry, you have any announcements or anything?
No. I have nothing going
Fantastic.
On in my life, and I'm chill with that.
Fantastic. Well, guys, I just can't reiterate enough that this album is a banger through and through. Every track is great. Please pick it up. It's on, I think High Tide has a distribution now, deal now, so you can get it on Amazon, like the actual LP on Amazon.
Nice.
You can order it through High Tide. You can ask your local record store. So please pick up this record. It's fantastic. Can't recommend it enough. They have another single out on High Tide, Macumba, I think is the, I didn't look it up, but I think that's the title. Really cool. So go check that out as well. And like I said, this is their third album, so they have two more before this to go check out. So lots of great stuff from these guys. I hope to hear more from them coming up soon. And as always, guys, well, first of all, Lester, thank you again for being here. We really appreciate it. And we hope that you, wherever you are happy and safe and healthy. And we'll see y'all next time. And
aloha.
Aloha. Cheers.
Cheers.
anymore.